Was nos waith dda bawb, good evening everybody. Croeso cynnes iawn i chi gyd i ddarlith Nadolig y Comisiwn. Heno, bydd tîm Cherish yn cyflwyno chwe blynedd o ddarganfod ar Gyrion Cymru. A very warm welcome to you all tonight to the Commission's Christmas lecture. Tonight, the Cherish team will be presenting 6 years of discovery at the edge of Wales. In a moment, I'll ask Claire Lancaster, the project manager, to introduce herself and her team. For those of you not watching this live, you're also welcome to send us any questions or say your comments, and the team will reply to them as soon as possible. Erbydd y sgwrs hwn drwy gyfrwng y Saesneg heno, cofiwch fod croeso i chi gysylltu â ni yn y Gymraeg os ydych chi'n am ofyn cwestiwn neu adael sylw. Felly, ar hynny o eiriau, drosodd i Claire Lancaster, rheolwr tîm Cherish, i gyflwyno ei hunan ac ei thîm.
Noswaith dda, good evening. It has been my privilege to be the project manager for the Cherish project and to work with the whole team for the last 5.5 years. And tonight you will hear from three of the archaeologists that work on the project, Louise Barker, Toby Driver, and Hannah Gendis-Boyd, and we'll be hearing about their individual highlights of the project. Some of you may have already been to our previous Christmas lectures on the Dinas Dinllaeth excavations and on Promontory Forts as well, as well as the talk by Alice and James at the start of the year through the Royal Commission series on the Bronze Bell Dive. But as the project draws to a close, this is a great opportunity to look at the work of the project and what it has done over the last 6 years, and indeed what we have discovered at the edge of Wales and in the less known areas of the project. So just to set the scene about Cherish, since the project began in 2017, we've witnessed and recorded erosion, exposure and movement to heritage along our dynamic coast, both in Wales and in Ireland. In 2018, four major storm events hit Wales, including the Beast from the East, and in June that year, we witnessed a major heat wave and drought event. During that year, winter storms and increased rainfall saw dramatic collapses at two important monuments, Dunbeg Coastal Promontory Fort in County Kerry in Ireland and Dinas Dinllaeth Coastal Hull Fort in Gwynedd. Such collapses take with it valuable archaeology and information about these special places, and what is vital is that we learn as much as possible about them before they're permanently lost to the waves. And that is exactly what Cherish is about. And with the investment of 4.9 million euros from the European funded Ireland Wales programme, we have achieved a considerable amount since 2017. For me, one of the greatest successes of Cherish has to be the collaboration between the four project partners and the two nations. And we've worked together, sharing and combining our skills and expertise to operate as a single survey team. We've learned so much from each other, and we hope that we can continue to build on these relationships in the future. But on with tonight. It would take us a long time to tell you about the work that Cherish has undertaken in 40 minutes. So we want to share with you some of the highlights that the team have been working on the project and between the two nations. You will hear highlights ranging from trips to less known islands, aeroplanes, armchair walks, discoveries, and the people that we have engaged with. So firstly, we will begin with Toby Driver. And I think, Toby, you're taking us across to an island and up in the air.
That's right, Claire. Thank you very much indeed. Nosferthar, pal, good evening, everybody. It falls to me this evening to share my first highlights of the project. And I thought tonight I would take you to two very special early medieval monasteries, one in Wales and one in Ireland. And we begin with a short video clip there showing a winter trip out to Puffin Island on a Cyril, just off the coast of Anglesey. And that was a trip Dan Hunt and myself made in November 2018, one of the last crossings that year by the Star Rider boat firm in Beaumaris out to Puffin Island on a cold day. But Puffin Island is a really special place. We worked there in 2018, and it was a real treat to get out to this beautiful island. You'll see an aerial photograph here. Puffin Island is home to an early medieval monastery founded around the 6th or 7th century AD. And later, there was a tiny, small church tower built in the 12th century, a Romanesque church tower. And it was aligned to Penmon Priory on the mainland as well. So a very important centre for religious sanctity and pilgrimage here in eastern Anglesey. There's no public access to the island today. It's privately owned by the Baron Hill Estate, and we're most grateful to Sir Richard Williams Bulkley, for allowing us access to the island twice in 2018. And we also went out with members of the Puffin Island Seabird Research Group, particularly Jonathan Green, who guided us from the boat landing through the overgrown island out to the church site. This aerial photograph you can see here, you may be able to read on screen as well, Henry Longueville Jones in 1849, saying it's a place to go if you want to see nature on a grand and unfettered scale. There have been many visitors out to Puffin Island, particularly in the Victorian period. Longueville Jones in 1849 and Harold Hughes, an architect from Bangor in 1900. There were excavations around that time as well. And this is renderings of this beautiful church tower. And you can see our own photogrammetric drone-derived 3D model from 2018 of this very special tower, which is so little visited. Now, Puffin Island, it's a sort of oval, long island with this saddle of ground in the center. And it was one of the first places we flew airborne laser scanning for at the start of the project. We commissioned a Blue Sky to go and fly seven islands off the Welsh coast. And you can see here this airborne laser scanning view of the entire island. It's very overgrown, there's not a lot to see, but the benefit of laser scanning means that we can strip away this vegetation quite magically and reveal the buried island hidden underneath that vegetation. And once we strip that vegetation away, you can see patterns of field boundaries, medieval ploughing, and the wide remains of the monastery right in the center of the island as well. And even we have a promontory enclosure at the tip of the island that's been revealed from this laser scanning. In this view, the circle in the center shows the site of the church and the now overgrown monastic remains. But the woodland to the left and on the right, you can see that island view without the woodland and the vegetation and all those additional field boundaries and archaeology we have related to the productive landscape surrounding this monastery and church. So a lot of new archaeology has emerged on this important island. The Cherish project is all about an interdisciplinary team working. And we are fortunate in 2018 as well as our field work on the ground, the Geological Survey of Ireland were able to visit with their survey vessel and do seabed mapping around Puffin Island and several other places to produce this 3D onshore offshore map, which shows the subsea dunes and sites of shipwrecks as well. So we've really produced a really interesting new data set for this island. Visiting Puffin Island in 2018 was a bit like going to a lost world. This is us arriving for the first time at the church. There's Jonathan Green from Liverpool University who guided us out there. And we have permission from Natural Resources Wales to cut back some of this vegetation to help with laser scanning of the church tower. But you see Hereford Hops there in 1868 had the same problem as us, a luxuriant growth of nettles preventing a survey of the church. So some things don't change. But what a special place to get out to. And then we revisited in the winter with the drone to do detailed drone photogrammetry of this church tower. And on the left, the lower image is a plan view of the church and its buildings derived from the drone. And at the top, the grey view, that's the laser scanning of the same plan view. So we now have these two excellent high resolution data sets of this remote tower, which have been used to monitor it into the future. So a little highlight there of Puffin Island, and I'll just finish my section just with the second highlight of mine, which has been doing aerial reconnaissance in Ireland. Now, a big ethos of the Cherish project was that, well, indeed, the whole European funding model is that ideas and expertise are shared between nations and we collaborate with other organisations. Now, in Wales, aerial reconnaissance to monitor and discover archaeology has been part of our work since the 1980s. And there has been a lot of aerial reconnaissance done in Ireland, but not on such a national basis. And so from the start, back in 2017, at the start of Cherish, we undertook aerial survey work in Wexford and Waterford in Southern Ireland, in 2019 around Dublin and Eastern Ireland, and then just this May in 2022 out in Kerry and Dingle. And we were training up members of staff from the Discovery Programme, learning from them, they were learning from us, and we've ended up with a really fantastic aerial archive. It's not just a case of going flying in a different country. One has to be sure that one's flying with an operator who can take you legally for aerial photography, that the insurance is placed. We're able to issue, at top left there, briefing notes for members of staff coming to fly with us. And there's a lot of flight planning to make sure we're targeting our flying towards the key monuments. On the right there in 2019, we needed to do some aerial survey of the islands in Dublin Bay, but these lie in the direct approach to Dublin International Airport in their air traffic zone. But we were able to work with Western Airport on the outskirts of Dublin, who were able to get us in with the permission of Dublin International at 500 feet above the sea level to do a new record of these islands. And in the centre, we passed on some of this good practice to students and heritage professionals in June 2019 in a flying school based at Western Airport. A really excellent day that we had there. Now, when you plan flying in another country in advance, you're planning a month or 2 months in advance for that. And we arrived in Dublin for flying on the 20th of March 2019 to perfect weather. Look at that steam arising from the power station in Dublin Bay, not a breath of wind. So Rob Shaw and I got a good couple of hours flying over Dublin Bay in the city. And we're able to see all the sites in Dublin Bay, get a new aerial record of these. Upper left, Ireland's Eye Island, with a church on it and a promontory fort. Upper right, Shenick's Island with a Martello Tower. You can see a Rockabill Lighthouse, Howth Lighthouse, and one of these wartime era symbols on Bray Mountain as well, Bray Head, to show that Ireland was independent in the war as well. So we have a huge photo record now of Dublin Bay in an area that's still very difficult to fly, either in a drone or in an aircraft. We made photographic records of the key islands, Dalkey Island here, just south of Dunleary, which has medieval, prehistoric and Victorian remains as well on it. And that's more recently the Discovery Programme have been out there to do drone photogrammetry as well. So really important photographic record of these islands. And sometimes a picture is worth a thousand words. This image of Rush housing development in Dublin Bay has been used subsequently in exhibitions and government exhibitions in Ireland. You've got some very attractive housing here in this settlement here, all gathered around that Martello Tower. You can see a Victorian Martello Tower as well, and an historic harbour. But look at the issues of coastal erosion and sea level rise affecting the housing here as well. So these pictures can be very powerful things, and they form an important photo record for our Ireland going forward. You can also see here the height we were flying at, between 400 or 500 feet, just to stay under that international air traffic as we were buzzing around Dublin Bay. But probably one of my biggest highlights of the whole project was our opportunity to fly in Kerry and Dingle in May this year. We talked about getting out there since 2017. We had various issues, both sides, and we had lockdown. We finally got out. And again, planning this trip a month or 2 months in advance, you're praying that the weather is going to be good. And look at this view down over Port Magee and Valentia Island, right in the Dingle Peninsula, in beautiful May weather. And this landscape is some of the most spectacular coastal landscapes that I've ever flown over. We were out there, we were flying with Rob and Ted and Hannah from the Royal Commission came out as well from the Cherish Project, flying out of Kerry Airport. I have to thank our pilot Barry from the Atlantic Flight Training Academy, who relocated the plane from Cork Airport to Kerry every morning so we could carry out our aerial surveys. And this is a stunning part of the world and full of study sites being monitored by the Discovery Programme particularly, that it was good to get a new aerial survey of. Just to share some of this stunning colour schemes you have flying over the Dingle Peninsula, clear seas, blue water, rhododendrons springing into life in May as well. It's a delight of the senses, and every cliff, every island has remote churches, monasteries, prehistoric stone forts. It's incredible. You can see here Derrynane Abbey, lower right there, and Ballinskellig's at the top with its coastal defences to prevent it from eroding. So over 2 days and several flights, we're able to monitor and get new images of the key baseline study sites for the Cherish Project. On the left, we have Ballinskellig's castle, little castle on a very fragile promontory extending into the bay, and very clear shallow water, good for recording archaeology like fish traps and other structures. And on the right, Ferretus Promontory Fort, which is the scene of excavations by the Cherish Project in 2019. You can see those scoops on the end, prehistoric and early medieval house sites. And you're never very far away from Hollywood on this peninsula, Ferretus. This is where one of the Star Wars films was filmed. And we talked to the landowner here as well, who'd had all that big circus happening on his land. Very interesting to meet the local people and talk about the archaeology and the lifestyle right out here in Western Dingle. Possibly my key highlight, and was on my bucket list since 2017, really, and all our bucket lists, I think, was to get some new aerial survey over Skellig Michael Monastery, which is 7 miles off the west coast of Dingle. This is one of two World Heritage sites in Ireland. It's one of the earliest and most important monastery sites in Ireland, and what a place to fire the imagination. This monastery set off on this spiky rock way offshore. We can only imagine the task of getting monks out there in rowing boats or hidebound vessels all those years ago. Dates from the 8th and 9th century AD, and we were lucky when we got out to the west coast to see this clear light ahead of us, and that was ready to go. We were able to fly out to Skellig Michael. And from an aerial archaeology point of view, this is my mobile phone view out of the window of the aircraft. Seeing the monastery Skellig rocks out of the window of the aircraft was hugely exciting. As we got closer, you can see boats in the lee of the island. These very lucky visitors getting out in this very rare weather window in May. It was quite a stormy May. And so they're all out that day. They weren't able to get out for the rest of the week because of the tides and the currents. And as we get closer, we see what makes this incredible place so special. In the foreground, Skellig Michael, rising to over 200 meters with an early medieval monastery on it and 600 steps to get up from the boat landing to the monastery site. And in the rear ground, Little Skellig, which is an internationally renowned gannetry as well. And you can see we come closer. On the left, South Peak, this high peak covered in monastic remains and a small hermitage. On the right, the ruins of a more recent lighthouse building as well, with this great road cut into the cliffs. And we orbit round. So on the South Peak, not accessible to the public, is a hermitage structure and steps for the monks to climb to that highest peak. And some of our colleagues from the Discovery Programme have made it up there. Then Christ's Saddle in the centre, where the 618 steps come to the top. And on the right, the monastery with these beehive huts and the small church where the monks slept and worked. And that's a close-up view there with the oratory and the monastery there. A very special place, very unusual to see this from the air, and a special place of pilgrimage still for so many people today. So those are my big highlights in the project. It's nice showing these highlights of these views here, but it's a rarity that getting out to Skellig, we may not get out there again for several years. So I made sure we took plenty of photographs. But as Barry, the pilot, takes us back into Kerry Airport, I'm gonna pass across now to my colleague, Louise Barker, to share her highlights.
Oh, thank you so much, Toby. Hopefully we've landed safely and we're now back on dry land, but we're not staying there for long, because for my highlight, I'm taking you to one of the most westerly lands in Wales, to the small island of Grasholm, which is actually 15 kilometres off the Pembrokeshire coast, so it beats the distance from the Skelligs. It's exposed and isolated, and it's relatively small. It measures just 500 metres by 420 metres, and that took us a 45-minute journey by jet boat, and I can tell you that journey often makes it feel like you're in a washing machine. We were absolutely soaked by the time we landed on that island. Grasholm is owned by the RSPB, for whom we're really grateful for permission to undertake our cherished work here, and landing really is strictly prohibited as it's a heavily protected wildlife sanctuary, famed for its gannets, some 32,000 pairs that breed here, which is one of the largest populations in the world. You can see them and their resulting guano from the white on the aerial image there. That's them all on the island, and often from the mainland of Wales, if you're looking out from Pembrokeshire especially, you'll often see the island, which appears as a tiny white rock on the horizon. It's a place of myth and legend, and it appears in the Mabinogion in the legend of Branwen. And Branwen's brother, Bendigedvan, was a giant who waded across to Ireland to do battle, but was slain. And fleeing from the battle, 7 men, along with the head of Bendigedvan, lived on Gwalis, the Welsh name for the island, for 80 years in a kingly hall with 3 doors known as the Assembly of the Wondrous Head. So the legends around the island may well originate from the settlement evidence that we actually have there. And it's this that Cherish has been studying, building on previous work by the Royal Commission. So our last visit to the island was in October 2019. And here's a short video clip showing you the island and us at work. The relationship here between the archaeology and the birds is really interesting. You can see the green of the turf cover where the birds aren't. And outside of that green, where you can see me walking in the red jacket there, you'll see this bare ground. And in that middle saddle is where you can start seeing stone spread showing of the archaeology. And as we turn round now to the other side of the island, you'll see all of the nests of the gannets there, which are now covering the archaeology. So here we have a process really of the birds, which are trampling their new ground and revealing archaeology, burning off the turf from the guano and then burying it from their nests. But really this archaeology is threatened, and that's really the main reason for all of our work here. And it's not only through the birds on the island, but it's also to do with weather, which obviously is set to worsen as a result of the climate emergency. Grasshom really does take the full force of the Atlantic weather, and we can see this impact. We can see that intense rainfall sort of gouges out rivers of mud and rock, taking with it some really precious finds. And there's also lots of drought and wind on the island, which desiccates the perforated surf and also all the former puffin burrows who were here on the island before. And then when you have storm events and waves overtopping and hitting the land here, you can imagine that what destruction that does to the precious archaeology on the island. So hence our reason for studying there. So what do we know about the archaeology on the island? Well, the first documented archaeological discoveries date to the early 20th century with a small collection of pottery, flint flakes and burnt stones, and fragments of the pottery survive in the National Museum of Wales. And analysis of that shows that they think it's to be Iron Age in date, so a couple of thousand years old. We also have a letter which reveals an excavation of a well on the island by archaeologists in 1946. And it's only this letter that reports large quantities of Roman pottery, including Samian ware, was recovered. We then have the famous naturalist R.M. Lockley to thank for drawing our attention to the actual archaeological remains on the ground. And this resulted in the Royal Commission archaeologist Douglas Haig making a visit to the island in 1963 to create the first record of the archaeology there. And following which he carried out a small excavation in 1972 across a series of conjoined structures. The image on the left that shows the map, it's the features on the left-hand side of that image, these conjoined structures. No finds were found, and these were interpreted as part of a settlement for catching birds or gannets, he suggested. But moving forward to 2012 and 2016, I was lucky enough to visit the island for the first time with some Royal Commission colleagues, including Toby. And here we were ground truthing some of the new Royal Commission aerial views of the island. And from this, we created a new archaeological map of the island, which you can see there on the left, which showcases a huge number of stone features, which includes roundhouses, cairns and field boundaries, and most of those are located from what we could record at the time in the central strip, the central corridor in the center of that aerial photograph. There you can probably make out some lines of stones there, and there's also some rectangular structures that we couldn't see so clearly, just preserved in the turf on the right hand side of the image. So in October 2019, Cherish undertook the next visit, principally to see if more archaeology had been revealed over the intervening 3 years as the gannet colony has grown. And this series of photos shows us at work, and also shows clear views of the archaeological features. And you can see the spread of stones in the top left. You can see a curving spread of stones, perhaps a sheepfold or similar structure. There's two cairns there shown in the bottom left and top right. And then the bottom right shows these wall lines of some fill boundaries that are there. So as well as the survey work, we were also fortunate enough to carry out a very small, due to the limited time available to us, trial excavation to assess one of the possible roundhouse structures on the island, which is shown here with our colleague Dan stood in the middle of the structure. It's tiny, it's around 4 metres in diameter. And we've always interpreted it as a very sort of temporary style structure, perhaps, you know, even likened to a goose house or an informal sheep shelter. So what did we encounter? Well, I have to say it was hugely challenging and smelly. It was not a good thing to dig. We were basically digging through fresh to slightly more rotted guano, and sadly meant that there was no finds at all. And we had to stop actually at a water table, which we hit some 34 centimetres down. But despite that, we were able to ascertain a really few crucial things. The first was this really was not a temporary style structure, but a very well built building with walls some 75 centimetres high. You can see some of the stonework revealed just about through the muck of the trench there. And probing also established there was a probable floor level down there at about 65 centimetres, which gives us a very, you know, well-built walls standing some 85 centimetres high. So with all of this from evidence, what is it revealing to us about the archaeology on Grasholm? So we have evidence of settlement on the island now from late prehistoric times, probably from the Iron Age, but also potentially into the Roman period and the medieval periods. And one question we now still ask ourselves is was Grasholm really as isolated as we perceive it today, or should we see it as a much more well-connected island in an international seaways? We have evidence of a small, well-built farming settlement, perhaps occupied seasonally. But does the myth and legend surrounding the island suggest something else, perhaps a Roman sanctuary or temple-like structure that's hidden there still under the turf? Was it also occupied during the early medieval period? And should we consider Scandinavian or Viking occupation here? And this always draws us back to this wonderful find on the nearby Smalls Island of the 11th century Viking sword hilt guard, which is decorated with a beautiful stylized animals, which really does provide us with a real tantalizing clue of also what might be around these shores. Every visit we make to the island reveals something new. And with the ever-changing nature of this island landscape and the way that the archaeology is revealed, we really hope that we can continue our work here in years to come to build up a better picture of the place. So for my second highlight, we're almost back to dry land, and I'm taking you up into North Wales to the Warren Beach near Appersock. And we're going to look at the cherished work in the very dynamic intertidal zone. Now, shipwrecks really are one of the principal features of such an environment. And here over the past 5 years, Cherish has been monitoring the exposure of an unnamed vessel, possibly that of the fossil, which is a 19th century wooden schooner, most likely associated with the slate industry of North Wales. We've been monitoring the exposure of the wreck, which was first recorded by the Royal Commission following winter storms in 2013. And you can see from this set of photographs, the exposure of the wreck changes with every visit. And on our last visit in early 2022, it's entirely disappeared. So why do we monitor monuments in such detail? You know, by photographing them and also taking beach profiles at each visit and comparing these against recent weather conditions, for example, storm events and wind direction, it can really help us going forward to best use our limited resources and person power to sort of target and monitor different stretches of coastline for exposed archaeology. And that's something we'll now be able to take forward. But our monitoring visits also revealed a few surprises on this beach. So in September 2018, during a very low tide, whilst we were filming for Weatherman Walking, Toby and Dan spotted timbers sticking out of the sand a few hundred metres to the east of our monitored shipwreck, which is shown on the left-hand side of this image. And the timber proved to be the remains of a previously unrecorded second wreck. The tidal window meant that there was only a very short time, around 30 minutes, to record what was there. And we did this using ground photography and through the use of a drone, which really has become, over the course of Cherish, our new favourite piece of equipment. And that's really revolutionised the way that we undertake our survey work now. We glimpsed the wreck again for a second time during monitoring in the autumn of 2019. But since then, it's we've never set eyes on it again since then. So it's again buried under the sand. But another exciting discovery on this beach came from the exposed peat deposits. At the top end of the beach, the peat deposit alongside fossilised tree roots and trunks are visible for most of the year. So it's the green streak that you can see in the top left of the image there. And here, preserved in the surface of the peat, we discovered animal footprints, such as the cloven prints shown on the top right image here, likely to be that of deer. We also discovered possible fragments of trackways shown on the bottom left, and also cuttings that were made into the peat, made in the last few hundred years, really, to extract the material for fuel. These peat deposits, which we see along the coast of Wales, there's so many famous ones, such as all of those around Borth and Ynys Las, really do offer us an exciting glimpse into a past environment. And this highlight and theme is something that our Cherish partners from Aberystwyth University, the Department of Geography and Earth Sciences, have been leading on. And working as part of this interdisciplinary team has been a key highlight for me in this project. You know, as an archaeologist, I've learned so much from working with the geographers and paleoecologists. So what does this peat represent? Well, they're indicative of lost ecosystems and environmental change, and they represent earlier freshwater wetland environments such as lakes or sort of the margins of slow flowing rivers. So therefore a habitat which was really rich in wildlife and resources. And these environments existed around what we now call the coast of Wales in prehistory, which was prior to their inundation from the sea, which was a result of the sort of melting of the vast ice sheets at the end of the last glacial period, some 12,000 years ago. And one of the questions we wanted to learn as part of Cherish about these peats was, on the Warren particularly, was how old were they and when were they inundated by the sea? And to answer that question, we have to take cores through the peat. And as you can see from this short clip, it's not an easy task, given how hard the peat is. In fact, we use a core barrel, which is attached to a jackhammer and drilled through the deposit. And we managed to take out a core of around 3 meters of peat. Now we put the core in, but it's equally as difficult trying to pull the core out, as you can see here. So it's a good 5-person team that's involved in extracting this kind of material. So finally for me, really, what were the results? Well, we were very lucky enough to locate 2 separate phases of peat development on the Warren Beach, and which was separated by an incursion of the sea. And that's indicated on by the band of grey between the 2 browner streaks shown on the core in the lower right image here. Now, this is really very exciting, as it shows here that the evolution of the landscape was not a straightforward story of sort of sea inundation at one point in time. And radiocarbon dating from the organic material from the peats, we now know that the deepest peat, which is lower down the beach and shown on the left hand side of the image, dates to the Neolithic period, some 7,000 years ago. Whilst the peat with our animal footprints in it dates to the Bronze Age, some 4,500 years ago. And just thinking about this as my finishing sort of little bit of a spiel here, this information really is crucial to our understanding of past environments and also to the finer details of sea level change at a more localized site-based level. And it also, for me anyway, it brings to life a different story about the coastal zone in Wales. You know, our beaches being places that were once wooded, freshwater environments that ultimately changed with rising sea levels. And I think it's this part of the climate story does provide us with a longer term context now to sort of the current and future risks that we are facing along our coasts. And now I'm going to pass you on to Hannah, who's going to share with us her highlights from the project.
Thank you so much. Great. Hiya. I'm Hannah Genders-Boyd. I'm Survey and Outreach Officer with the Cherish Project, and this is Pufty, who, if you've followed the project from the ARC, you'll know our trusty mascot, who you might have noticed cropping up in some pictures there. So I'm going to share with you just quite briefly some of my highlights from the outreach and engagement work we've done over particularly the last year that I've been involved in the project. Outreach and engagement is really important to the Cherish Project. Toby and Lou have just told you all about some of the amazing research we do, and it's super important that we don't just keep that for ourselves or only share that with the research community or the academic community, and take it further, both out into the heritage sector, but also out to people who have an interest in coastal heritage. And very often that will be the people who live on the coast. So engaging coastal communities is a really important part of what we do. And over the last year, that's involved a bunch of different approaches to that kind of engagement work. That's included community excavations, talks like this one, which we do fairly regularly, outreach walks, engaging with the media, a remote tour, our armchair walk, which I'll tell you more about in a moment, and the creation of online resources. So this is a nice snap here from our Carvi walking tour that we did earlier in the year, although at this moment in time it was more of a lying down tour, which is always very nice. Lou and Pufty listening to Julian, our Royal Commission Maritime Officer, talking about some of the maritime trade going on at that forum, which was a great bit of collaboration with other Royal Commission colleagues. And here we have another lovely picture from that day at Carvi. This was a really, doing these kind of walks was a great opportunity to talk to the people of that community about our research, but also hear about their experience of heritage on the coast and their interactions with their local heritage, and also a really brilliant opportunity to start talking about climate change, talk about the climate crisis and its effects on coastal heritage. So this is a really good way to get out and talk to people directly and see what people have to say. On the right there, we've got another image with some collaboration with other Royal Commission colleagues, which was a open day at Castlebach Promontory Fort in Ceredigion, where we've done various bits of survey work. That's another coastal promontory fort. And this whole outreach day was an opportunity for us to talk a bit more about our methodologies. So we often get a chance to talk about our research and our findings and what we found out. And this was a good chance to talk about how we found out and take out some of our kit. So including things like our drones that Lou was talking about earlier, that's been so important for coastal research, and GNSS kit and things like this, and get people interested in that. And that was some older members of the community and also some young people and some children as well who showed quite strong interest in these things. So that was great to see. This of course means that if we're doing these kind of walks, it's really just limited to whoever can get to that part of the coast on that day. So it's been important to us to extend that reach. And one way that we've done that is to extend the reach by engaging with the media. So on one of our outreach walks this summer, we were accompanied by BBC Radio Wales with the Country Focus programme. So that was really a great opportunity to have this, the Cherish research that has national implications, give it a national reach. And that was a highlight for me because I'd not done something like that before, and it was really exciting to think about this research going out to a wider audience. And there's a nice snap of us with the producer with her clipboard ready for us to produce there. And that reach, of course, also has some implications for accessibility. And accessibility is something that's been really important to think about, and it's really important to us here at the project. With doing outreach and engagement, we're really aware that when we're doing things like outreach walks and outreach days, that requires people to be able to get to the coast. And also requires a certain level of physical fitness to get out on the coast path. So we tried for a new approach to that with our armchair walk that we trialled this year, which was which was innovative and very low tech. And that was me and Toby out with a selfie stick going around Flintston Bay Promontory Fort and giving a talk about the day. That's us looking very windblown because it was super windy. But it was a really great opportunity, and we had some good feedback from people saying they wouldn't have been able to join us on the day, and it was great to be able to watch that online. So that felt like, for me, a real highlight to do something innovative and try something new and to capture a new audience in doing that. So you'll be able to see that online in the new year. We're just putting some captions to it so it can be read as well as heard. And then that'll be going out on YouTube, so it'll be widely available. And we have some more, I guess, high-tech ways of engaging people, like remotely as well. So that on the top right corner there, that's a picture of one of our 3D models, which we've been creating throughout the entirety of the project as a research tool, but now is, of course, also an amazing engagement tool. So that's created from a photogrammetric scan of the site, but now can be used to have a kind of 3D tour from your computer. So you can find one of those on our website via a website called Sketchfab, and there you can take yourself around a site using the 3D tours, which is really good fun and learn something along the way. So to do this Flintston Bay Promontory Tour, that was involved in doing some collaboration with the MOD, because it's MOD land. And collaboration has certainly been something that's been really important to this project. And so that brings me on to my next highlight, which was some of the community excavations that went on this year. Cardvai Promontory Fort, where we started off with doing those remote walking tours, has also been excavated last year and this year for a collaboration with Dig Ventures. And I think there might be some representation from Dig Ventures in the audience tonight as well. So hello if you're there. In 2021, we collaborated with Dig Ventures, which is a business that runs archaeological digs, for anyone who doesn't know, to excavate a Cardvai Promontory Fort. And that was such a success that they came back again this year to fund that themselves. But again, accessibility is really important for the Cherish project. So we wanted to fund some aspects of that, including a dig school for local teenagers to be able to attend, and some placements for early career young people to be able to attend. And on the right-hand side there, we've got two lovely snaps of two of the young people who came and took up these placements. And one of them, Elise, wrote us this fantastic blog afterwards, which I would fully recommend people to go and read on our website, because it makes for lovely reading. They did a fantastic job of it. And this was a real highlight for me to read what they had written there, of there on the right, saying that this placement was really important for them to be able to attend, and they had a really great time, and that might have changed their career path and their life path a little bit, which is an exciting thought. So nearly finally now, my last highlight from this past year has been a more political highlight of taking our Cherish exhibition down to the centre, which was really a great experience for me. It was my first time visiting the centre, being quite new to Wales and seeing it actually being quite like Holyrood, where I've come from in Edinburgh. And seeing the political engagement both from the climate change minister, Julie James, and from the vice consul for Ireland, Niall Veal, was just brilliant, and great to have these conversations more around climate heritage policy and what we do with this data going forward, what this means for our countries. And good to see people in government sitting up and paying attention to this and really engaging, which is excellent. So to finish up from me, I guess an overall highlight would be the sense that Cherish is leaving a positive legacy when it ends this next year, in not too long. But not only this sense of outreach and engagement, raising awareness for coastal communities and giving this long-term context and archaeology being really relevant in where we're at the minute, also these amazing, this new data that you can now access online totally for free because of the European funding. And also excitingly, our conference in 2023 that we'll be wrapping up our whole project with, and also launching our toolkit at, which is a summary of all the different techniques that we've used over the course of the project, and the different ways that people both heritage professionals and communities can work in the coastal and intertidal and maritime zones to do this kind of recording. And you are all invited. So please check out our Eventbrite for that and see if you would like to come along. It's going to be in Dublin in March. And we'll share the link to the Eventbrite in the chat at the end of this lecture. So that is all from me and from us. And I'll just finish up with this and pass back to Claire.
Thank you, Hannah, and thank you all of you. I hope everyone found it interesting to hear about the work on that the team have chosen as their highlights, and particularly the work on Puffin Island, as there's no public access to it. And it's a great opportunity for people to hear about the work that Toby carried out in Ireland and to see the amazing features and similarities between the two nations. It's also great to hear about one of the smaller islands that we visited in Grasholme, and I think the team deserve a special mention for digging through that guano, which I know took a while to get rid of the smell of when they got back. And also the intertidal peat discoveries have been as another highlight, and the collaboration between the university and the commission show how valuable a joint survey team has been within the project. And it was great to see all of the outreach and community engagement and the sunny weather that we had back in July and August on a cold winter's evening. And I personally thoroughly enjoyed watching the armchair walk that was subject to one of the Royal Commission's lectures. And I think that both Toby and Hannah were very brave to go at the end of the cauldron, go to the edge of the cauldron at the end of the video to show us into the deep abyss that it was there. And I look forward to us trying to hopefully squeeze a couple more armchair walks in next year before the project finishes. So stay tuned for news about those. I think it's probably safe to say that we've been very busy over the last 6 years, and we could probably go on for hours about the work that the project has done. As Hannah mentioned, we've got newsletters and lots of resources online. So there's 10 newsletters available that we've produced throughout the project, and you can read those at your leisure. And also please check out the Cherish YouTube channel, because that has the dive diaries from the Bronze Bell wreck, and also the Channel 4 news piece, which is another highlight of mine, is that we managed to get onto the national news with quite a substantial piece about climate change and coastal heritage. And the Cherish guidance will be released next year, which will have more interesting case studies for you to read about on the work of Cherish. But that's enough from us. We're now ready, and I hope you've all noticed that we're all in our Christmas jumpers. And so we're ready to answer any questions. So we will stop sharing the screen and hand back to Dave for those questions.
Great. And diolch yn fawr iawn I chi gyd am sgwrs ddiddorol iawn ac atgoff am waith gwych dros y chwe blynedd diweddaf. Thanks to you all for a very, very, very interesting talk and a reminder about all the fantastic work over the past 6 years. Rydyn wedi derbyn ambell I sylw a questions. We've received a number of comments and questions. I'm going to kick off with one from Dominique, who says, how can we find information about the walking guided tours in the future? Are there any more planned to start with? And then if there is, where do we get the information?
Yeah, great. So maybe I'll answer that. A good place to start is always our website. We'll always update what we're doing on the website. There'll be less happening in the next year because the project's going to wrap up in June. So this was kind of one of our last chances. But as Claire said, make sure we do more armchair walks and online talks in order to get people engaged with what we're doing over the next year. And there will be more interesting findings because we're still putting stuff out. So keep an eye on our website. There's a tab that says events, and it's all under there. And we can share that link in the chat as well, so you can find it easily.
What I would also say is that the Royal Commission obviously will send out any details as well through the Friends Network. And even though Cherish is finishing, there are plans to work and do some more guided walks with the Pembrokeshire Coast National Park as well towards the end of the summer next year. So keep an eye on, like Hannah says, the website, but also social media channels as well, because news will be announced on there as well.
Okay, thank you very much. We've got a question from Alison, which says, What trades were routes were adjacent to the sites, and at what and did they change over time?
Well, the coastlines of Wales and Ireland have been very well visited since the 3rd and 4th centuries BC, and thence on through. The Irish Sea and the Celtic Sea there, St George's Channel, was a bit of a motorway, really, before the Romans came to Wales and Britain, and thence afterwards as well. Reading up about Skellig Michael Monastery this last week, I see that it was visited and possibly even founded by Welsh saints, Arwisley and others, Taylor and so on, travelling out there. So today, for us to get to Skellig Michael, we have to get a ferry from Wales. Well, if you're in Ireland, you have a five-hour drive down there. Then you have to wait for the weather to be good for the boat, a big diesel-powered boat to take you out there, which takes 2 hours. And then you have to land, and you can't land if the tide's wrong. So we think back to the 6th century AD, when you had a hidebound rowing boat to take monks out there. What a trip, you know. So, you know, we have very, very good evidence of trading and contact on the Welsh and Irish coasts for 2,000 to 3,000 years. But we have to think about those sailors and the journeys they made to bring sort of culture and contact between the two nations before the age of steam and diesel, really. Amazing. Yeah,
and I think just even looking at our excavations at Carvi Promontory Fort, some of the finds that were coming out from that, from the excavations there, there's the pottery suggested some might be salt containers. So salt was being brought in and probably exchanged and traded. And possibly importantly for the, for Wales particularly, what were we exchanging and trading out? You know, this is a country rich in mineral resources, so perhaps the evidence of metalworking from copper and such like. And then if you head straight all the way through to the sort of 19th, 20th century, I mentioned the slate wreck, which was another one of the commodities out of North Wales. So all the shipping that was going up and down the channel from that period as well.
Okay. Thank you very much. There's a few questions now about where to get further information and sort of follow-up things. So Alan asks, will there be a chance to attend the Cherish End of Project conference via Zoom? Or alternatively, will there be an online recording of the event?
So yes, there will be an online recording. We're not going to do it live streamed, but the whole thing will be recorded and put up afterwards. So if you're not able to come and join us in Dublin, then you can still experience all of the talks.
Okay, great. And Lee asks what the name of the YouTube channel is. So I guess we can get that posted out to people. But Hannah, if you say that off the top
could
of your head.
Share it in the chat.
I've put the link in the chat for.
Brilliant. Okay.
But if you search Cherish Project, just one word on the internet, it tends to come up with our website and the
YouTube. Yeah, if you're struggling to find it on YouTube as well, then you can go on our website and click on the YouTube icon in the top right hand corner, which is sometimes a little bit easier to find.
Great, thank you very much. One question there. And Rebecca asked quite a sort of big question, and I think it's probably, I'm not sure if she intends everybody to answer this, but the question is, how did you get involved in the project, or what was your route into the Royal Commission? I suppose Lou and Toby have been members of staff commissions for some time, so I think it was a natural fit for them to take part in the project. But it might be interesting to hear from Hannah and Claire as well. And sort of, Lou, did you mention something?
Yeah, I was going to start off by saying, obviously, Toby and I were at the Royal Commission previously, so I just wanted to start really by saying the idea around the project came from work that the Commission had already been undertaking along the coast of Wales and looking towards the future. You know, we started planning this project. It's been running for nearly 6 years, but the planning for the project probably stretched for, you know, 2 years before that. And at that point, you know, the impact of the changing climate and climate change was slightly on the radar, but nowhere near where we're at now with, you know, climate emergencies and that. So that was our sort of horizon scanning at the time. So for myself and Toby, it was certainly building on work that we've already were undertaking as part of the Royal Commission. But obviously for Hannah and Claire, it's a different story.
Yeah, and I guess for me, I'm the newest member of the Royal Commission Cherish team. And previously I've been working in climate heritage with Historic Environment Scotland up in Edinburgh, and also doing paleo-environmental research in Orkney, very north of Scotland. And I think, it's worth saying that the time that I when I was up in Scotland doing that, the Cherish project has always been like a very highly regarded project, and really always seen by other people working climate heritage in the other four nations as like hugely cutting edge research and a really, really kind of sector leading project. So as soon as I heard about it, I, you know, had my eye on what Cherish has been doing for a long time before joining the project. And then it was, you know, a brilliant opportunity to be able to bring down my expertise from Scotland to join Wales, to join this project.
Great. Thanks so much, Alan. And Claire, do you want to say?
I'll just say that I'm not an archaeologist in any way, shape or form. My background is in environmental science and nature conservation, and the years working for the Welsh government and other governments in various guises. And I just moved back from Brussels, having been out there for a 3 and a bit years stint as working with one of the ambassadors out there. And the job came up, and it was a project management job, and I thought, well, I can boss people around. So that's why I took the job. And I think it's an amazing project to work on, not just because of it's the team that makes it. And I think the working between Ireland and Wales and the four project partners has amazed me, that it's a great team. Everyone gets on well with one another. And it's a shame it's coming to an end, but I think what it's delivered in the last 6 years should be applauded, really. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, indeed. I think it's fascinating to see, you know, all the different skills that have come together to put this project on. And you can see the people from our organisation, that the skills they brought to the project, but also, of course, all different partners as well. So, I mean, it just covered so many bases, which I think is the real strength of the project. We've got a question from Catherine, and it says, what are your top three recommendations for future Ireland Wales joint research? Big question for you there. with of course unlimited funding.
Oh, that'd be fantastic.
Well, there's a lot of interest, always a lot of interest in the early medieval period in monastic Wales and Ireland, and I'm not sure there's been too much done across both nations on that front.
I would go with promontory forts. I think, you know, we've started our study on them through Cherish on both sides of the coastline, and I think there's a lot more that can be looked into in terms of the similarities or not, and also just more understanding. And for me, it's one of the most at-risk monument types, really, just given their coastal nature. So more work on that would be my gambit.
That's cool. Yeah, and I would maybe say, maybe kind of alongside both those, the work that's been done on the paleo peats in both nations has been so exciting and really, like, brought up a lot more information. So I think there's plenty more research to be done on the peats in both Wales and Ireland.
Okay, great. Thanks for it. Well, that's all the questions. We've had lots and lots of comments in the chat as well. People kept joining us from Tennessee. Kimberly says hi from Dig Ventures, and there's lots of other people. thanking you for a fascinating talk as well. So Jock and Val Hin Waifeto am Skor Squeech Akan am Ateb a hot question. If you've got any further questions, you're more than welcome to contact us after the talk, either through social media or by using the contact details on our website. Igloi, Hoffin Jock and Val Hin am Amino Ani Heno, I staff a commission am Drevni, Achanolav, Jock and Val Yawn, Ichi Hanna, Toby, Lou, Achler am Skors Dodori Yawn. Thank you to all of you for joining us tonight, and to the commission staff who've been involved with the arrangements, and of course to Hannah, Toby, Lou and Claire for a fascinating talk. Nos da a nadolig llawen a blwyddyn newydd dda I chi gyd.